dedicated to let's get started. Principles of effective experience. So this is the continuation of last week's lecture. So the lectures, as you'll see from now on the book, strengthening the first part of the lecture is about the general discussion behind it. The second part is about these evolved best practices that are already well known and well understood in the debate. First, before we get on to that, let's talk about chapter 3. So, pick one input modality and describe it. Who wants to describe what kind of input modality? Ooh, toys.
Project.
Yeah, toys. Okay, so who would be able to pick the input modality and describe it? Nobody would be able to pick it. Point and click, so that's an input modality. So how would you, what description might you give to that? Which is my exact question, please.
Well, the user uses some kind of tracking device to select items on the screen by triggers a menu that has items which are dropped out of the select.
Okay. And why you also say anything more about the cognitive load, or is it easy to do, is it hard to do, do you remember it?
It's designed to allow the user to see multiple things and interact with multiple things at the same time.
Okay.
To focus their attention specifically on one thing.
Okay. And is it easier to actually to say one thing? Is that easier to do with the memory than to do with your key presence or memory shortcuts?
Because it's quite intuitive.
Yeah, so it's quite intuitive, but it will shortcuts, so the balancing of the shortcuts is the default. It's a lot faster if you're an expert user and you use it all the time. So you've got the balls to do that, and you'll watch the notes. If you leave, if you don't use the actual application for a while, then it takes longer to remove the memory of the shortcuts, right? But in reality, when it comes in slow, it's just easier for numbers or somebody who doesn't use the same application all the time to use. And that's why point and click. It was a good, it's a reasonable, well, because what really why we wanted one was not wanted to, that non-expert users don't use the same, they use different applications, not all the time, say, are able to quickly learn how to get around the interface again without remembering shortcuts, right? Okay, so that kind of discussion, that kind of input modality, that kind of discussion is something that we need to consider when we're on. Four main sensory channels and briefly explain them. So who wants to tell me what one type of sensory channel? Not you. Yes.
Olfactory.
So if we've been describing olfactory, what would that be?
Sense of smell.
Sense of smell?
Yes.
Okay, and what also does that relate to?
Taste. Yeah.
So you've got smell and taste as part of the somatic system. Okay, so if that's the case, why do we care about taste and why do we care about smell when it comes to the sight and the experience?
Well,
the
chapter
kind of
mentioned that it's like a newer thing that was just a little bit of a two kind of get off the house and it relates to the memory, like it really is like past experience really well.
Yeah, so they can say the smell and taste people remember to past experiences, so they're evocative, right? So they evoke some kind of something.
Yeah.
So if it was me, and I was looking at these questions, these bits and pieces, I'd also go link it to affective, or to at least emotional computing. So how can you, that might be informative of certain emotions, which might make people feel better or worse about the application they're using. You might also reference Steve Bruce's work at Glasgow about systems specifically for using smell in computer sites, so that different vials and different kinds of smell, they heat up and evaporate based on what kind of work for the real interface. So that you can actually remember the nouveau word by the smell. Okay? He wants to give me another central channel. so it's like, so auditory is not just about the audio, although that's obviously what it's mainly about, but it's also other effects, much about what's going to be here. It's other stuff, so some of that might be, as I say, vibration, you know, and that's called a, it's called haptic, but what we call it in the context of auditory. Head effect or skill effect. Right? And so those things are useful. If I was riding, if you wanted to just pick the loop top down there, or the joints together for your original thought, you might say that this is useful for, well, so bone conductive hedge bones, in fact that's why they were invented, that's why they were created, bone conductive hedge bones, and that's good because you can still hear sound, which means when you're cycling along on your bike, you can hear the cars about to kill you, or it means when you're running along, you can hear the people about to look at your iPhone and you're listening to. So that means that you've got bone conductivity, which you're hearing, but you can also be still alert, you've still got situational awareness. So what I'm trying to get across to these is that you need to know a lot more than just saying, oh, yeah, auditory is hearing done. Okay. Link it to other things, have some additional ideas about how you're going to describe additional force about what you're saying. How does UX relate to previous human factors work? How does you, I mean, I've asked this question four times over the course of, yeah, I've been counting since on video, yes.
Like, tries to make it less reductionist by making it richer and taking into account, like, emotions and subtleties.
Yes, so it makes it, tries to make it less reductionist, tries to make it more qualitative, than quantitative, makes it deeper, makes it richer, even though we've made it as generalizable, you might tell me. Unless we think that we all share a part of the human condition and are more in this kind of rich that is generalizable because we all share the same kind of condition. The previous work, so previous work was very what? But if UX work is more
quantitative,
what's the old way?
Quantitative.
Okay, so the old sort of quantitative. A lot of the options, so they're trying to make it more scientific by quantifying things more so we can compare things better. When we have comparisons, we compare one thing to another thing, the same thing, we've got the times view, the fastest time is the best. Yeah, that's why we have fit score. I might take the site fit score as an example of the old HCI quantitative kind of way, and I might cite something else as a qualitative. Okay, which we'll be getting to later. Okay. What's affective computing mean? And there's a difference here between affective and emotional. What about emotional computing, which is stuff that we've been doing in a couple of weeks? Why is that different to affective? Yes?
Isn't affective measuring?
So affective, there's a difference here, yeah. Affective computing, affective computing, is a term that's used now a lot in the circles whereby they want to give computers out emotion. The idea is that they want computers to feel. And what's more, they also want recognise so as to think. And the word, the main protagonist of this is Rosalind Carr at MIT. Okay. So that's the difference. Whereas if we're looking at the emotional factors of a system, that's why that's they're trying to say, how can we take into account, in some cases for evil, take add an emotional connection between the machine and the person. Effective computing is about how can we get the machine to recognise emotions and to have them. Okay.
Yeah, so I don't think, yeah, anyway, you're the next week. Well, that's this kind of main deal on it. But the emotional stuff, how do we actually get the emotional response going to, well, really, it's on the human side, how do we listen to that so that we can feel better about interaction? That's why robots, right, are designed with VRs and that kind of stuff, right? So that they're interested in the world, and maybe you can that. It's just a bit, it's maybe it works, right? So there we are. Who's seen Short Circuit, the famous 1990s film, Bizarre Robot, is it Short Circuit? Anybody? Hey, nobody's seen that film, though. It's like a weird... There's a recent one, Disney film, where there's a robot that's kind of collecting trash for players. Well, yes! Molly, that's right, yeah, that's all night. Everybody's going, oh, yeah, well, it's really great. It would be very good if it was just, you know, sort of a bizarre disembodied arm. You know, crushing stuff with it, they'd be like, well, there's no relationship there, but because someone's put some eyes on it, and we're all big, you know, great, it's just got some circuitry. It's just a machine. Okay. Describe the difference between gestural interfaces and touch gestures. So, gestural interfaces and touch gestures. What do you think is the difference between gestural interfaces and touch gestures? What's a touch gesture? Yes? Yes, that's true. So generally, what we can say is that touch gestures are more about two-dimensional interactivity, right? So we've got two dimensions, which we're just doing on the screen, on a touch surface, on a flat surface, whereas gestural interfaces are more three-dimensional. And as I said, you can categorise touch gestural interfaces, those that are around things like, kinetic, the leap, motion, those kind of things, because they're three-dimensional gestures. And then we've got ones that are just standard, you know, multi-touch gestural interfaces like the one on the touch screens. Okay, so these self-assessment questions at the end of chapter 3, you should obviously be thinking about this is a good way for you to go to answer these, and you also need to think of ways not just to answer them as flat questions, if you like. I'm just going to answer exactly what's there, but some discussion around, you know, to show your short or greater knowledge is always a good thing. And it's always a good thing, but else is it a good thing when you actually think it's half a bit? If it's not just on the next app, where else might you want to show off your greater knowledge if it's not just on the next app? Or that you can connect things together around topics, yes? In an interview, yes, getting a job, always good, right? So if I'm getting jobs, they say, oh, tell me about this, what do you think about this? It's not really good to go, you know, quite there to answer your question. You want to discuss around it so that you show you've got some world experience, etc.
Creating a job.
Huh?
Creating a job.
Creating a job. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, so let's go. Possibly, these are the... So last week we were talking about... What were we talking about? The last lecture last week. Good question. You don't know. You don't know. People were here. Yeah.
Huh?
Effective computing. How can we be effective in action? So that's what we were talking about last time. What were we saying last time? Why is it effective computing not called accessibility? Why do I call it effective computing when you might call it accessibility? Screen real estate state, small screens, is a kind of visual disability.
you're being disabled by the technology, and that's where the situation will require. So those are the things that why it's useful. If you design it well at the start, which includes the ability for everybody to work on the technology or use the technology, that means it's a lot easier at the end. Okay, you don't have to change things because you allow people to have flexibility in the system. How might you get flexibility in the system? You've got program logic, you've got the program logic, and then you've got the interface. How might you be able to get flexibility in the interface away from the actual implement a controller. Okay, so you implement a controller. Where's the controller from? What kind of framework the controller come from? NBC, probably controller. Okay. Yeah. All right. So, you kind of have to yes, that's a good one. Separation of concerns. So therefore, you separate the concerns, which means you decouple the interface from the program logic. Okay, that means you can change the interface to anybody. The way it's presented doesn't matter. So the actual information, the logic of the working this out is right there. That's very easy to do that decoupling. You might also use different kinds of frameworks for your program. Okay. So if you see how parts of the course can be joined to other parts of the course, and that's how you should be thinking. It's not looking for separating into siloed topics. You should be making these associative links between different parts of the course. Okay. You should certainly do it now. You're the hardcore, you're down to like 50 people. Okay, so, in the world outside of this one, what I'm telling you about now is called accessibility. Accessibility is about visual disability, it's about hearing disability, it's about physical disability, it's about horrible term older users who are inherently disabled down the mess. Okay, so these are the things that it's about in the world outside, right? So I am serious in this. But I'm telling you both topics, both giving you both viewpoints if you like. So here is what the world sees as the things that you need to be thinking about for access technology, okay, for efficient technology. And it's called PORR, okay? And PORR means perceivable, operable, understandable, and robust. So here we see perceivable. The first thing is, can you see it? Now, see is in quotes, because that doesn't really mean it. Can you see it? Can you get to the information? Is it centrally available to you? Okay. So, where I say see, you might want to put here. Okay. You also, where I put see, you might want to also put understand if the context is about cognition or cognitive disability. Okay. That's different than understanding in two ways. So, first of all, when you're thinking about this kind of stuff, when you're designing your systems, you should think to yourself, well, what happens if I switch the monitor off? Are you still able to use the system if there's no monitor? And if you can't, then that's what 10% of the population, more of the global population, that's a problem that they've had. Okay? Yeah, 10% might be a visual disability, they're lost. So, there's a lot of people worldwide who have a lot, you know, the actual instance of blindness in different countries are, you know, very different. Obviously, you get lots more disabilities, blind disabilities as you get older as well. So, in the Asian population, you do get blind from the blind people because you get a higher prevalence of things like macular degeneration, both white and brown. Okay, so the next thing is operable. So the first thing talks about, really, sensory stuff. Operable. The second thing talks about physical stuff. So can it be operated? So if your system doesn't have shortcuts, and I'm blind, how am I going to be able to do target selection to get my eyes? if you are not sure across the board. How will I know? How will I be able to select the target? The answer is you won't. Okay, so it won't be easy. Also, with regard to operable, if you put the actual size of the button or the size of the selection target as being too small, then how are you able to select that if you've got tremor or you've got physical disability? Are you able to control the cursor by just the cursor? The actual pointer, should I say, which is normally called by control by mouse. Can you control it by cursor keys such that you're able to control the location better if you're using the Julian switches, which is using some place switches, etc.? Or you can only use a small limited amount of the key presses. Okay. So is it operable? Are you able to operate this thing? So these questions you should be asking yourself as you're building this stuff. Understandable. Can you understand it? So understandable, in the terms of accessibility, typically understandable is about cognitive. Okay. It's about cognition, learning difficulties, learning disorders, these kinds of things. And so that's one part of it too. Well, the other part is, do you know anything? Can you actually do anything with regard to understandability if it is to do with other things like literacy? If it's to do with other things like language? If it's to do with things such as educational standard or educational level? Okay. So, is it understandable to people on the ground? But we can see that a lot of manuals, technical manuals, aren't understandable to most people. Okay, they're just not. So why is that? And also, is it robust? So is it fault tolerant? Will it fall over at the first possible, will it fall over? The reason why this is critical for people with accessibility problems is that if the system falls over, then things stop talking, stop working. There's no reason to know why that is. Sometimes it's just because the software that people are trying to use is crap. It's there, it's working, it's just not talking. But if it's robust, if it's not robust and it's fallen over, then that means that you don't know whether it's just that the software is rubbish and it's not talking anymore, or that the actual whole system's fallen over. There's no way to find out. Once the system's over, there's no way to find out if it's not. Okay. So. Like I said, I don't hold with B-Sport only. I don't think these are all that there should be. But these are the ones that the various standard organisations, especially work centred around Judy Brewer at the W3C, the Web Consortium, Web Accessibility Initiative grouping. That's what they've come up with. And these have now made their way into most of the standards. So they've made their way across lots of standards and into ISO standards, not just for the web, but for standard conventional applications. Okay. So, one way to remember this, I think, is this is my set, and it's slightly different. Okay. So, if I ask you a question about what are the major issues, what are the main things that you need to be looking at on exams, I'll be either telling you it's my ones or the general. So we can see perceivable and operable, that's fine. We also can see understandable, that's likewise fine, we know what that is. Things that I think need to be thought about more are is open and flexible. Okay. These are critical in my opinion to effective use. Okay. So open, is it open to programmatic extension? That's the first thing. So for instance, it doesn't matter if Twitter don't build an app for a suit to visually disabled users. Because they've an open API, and the specialist can build an app for visually disabled users by just decoupling the interface from the program logic. So all they're doing is calling the APIs. How they present that information is entirely down to the user, down to the programmatic extension command. Okay. And that's something critical. So if you've got a piece of software and you don't have APIs for it, you don't allow it to be open, you don't allow it to be extended. And that means that unless you are God and have thought of every single circumstance where this might be used, you might very well be injuring somebody's use. Are any of you God? in the stars. Oh, at the back. Nice. Which is according to things in my imagination. Anyway, there we go. So, that's why we need open systems, because we can't reject, we can't judge anything. We don't know how this will be. We don't know. We're probably mostly not experts in the needs and the requirements of people on the spectrum. So that's one of the reasons why we need to be open, in my opinion. And of course, at the end, you can disagree with me, and in the exam, if you want to write a whole diagram about how I'm wrong, then yeah, that's okay. Next, is it flexible? So flexibility really gets around problems of things. Flexibility really gets around the problems with, that can be inherent in the system if it's not open. Even if it is open, maybe you only need to make a few things flexible to get a lot more audience share, if you like, to get a lot more people who are going to buy this stuff. So, it might very well be that you're able to change the colours. Why might you want to change the colours?
Colour blindness.
Colour blindness. So you might want to change the colours. Colour blindness. You might be dichromic, trichromic, colour blindness. You might need to change those colours in different ways so you can actually perceive the interface. Okay, so that's one reason. You might want to allow flexibility to come as a layer of skin. You know, so you can skin, you change the skin on the surface so that things change, because that's what people want. So there's a difference between having this openness of data where you can do full-scale development, where you're expecting full-scale development, or having a layer which is flexible so you can skin it such that it does things where you've got new design application where it allows for flexibility. And also some personal flexibility, but some coarse granulated, if you like, flexibility, because that flexibility can be packaged up by an expert, which you mentioned later on. Why might openness be good outside of the accessible domain? Why might it be good in general? Why might openness be good in general? Community participation, but in the context of open to programmatic extension, I mean. So that's one reason, yeah, but any more. Because it means that if you built an open API, one, you can make sure that your internal developers and your internal user experience people are decoupled, so you don't have to push the hell out of each other all the time. So this is how one way to separate concerns, even from your own code. And secondly, do we think that openness, if we provide APIs, is more testable in the testing and development environment? Because it's pretty difficult to test interaction in the testing and development environment. Although the problem is things will work on behavioral tests. Maybe they're not. It's not that. It's really far forward from that. So it allows better development. It allows better separation of concerns. It allows politics within the organisation to work better, because you don't have people arguing with each other about how things should be implemented and developed. It also means that you don't have to take into account every single platform onto which you want this to be deployed. Because if you're using some nice now multi-platform backend, such as, Go, then you can easily make a nice front end, or you can change the front end based on whatever it's called, whether it's the desktop or the tablet or whatever else. We know that front-end interfaces are, well, do we think that front-end, flexible front-end interfaces are at the moment tricky, or indeed dead? What about the Ubuntu project, so the Ubuntu project, or even the Microsoft project, that Active Tiles, what's that trying to do? What's the Ubuntu interface project trying to do? Unity, there's a clue.
Reinvent interface?
Huh?
Reinvent user interface?
Yes.
For the new system that makes use of the data and possibly why for this 20 years
old? No, that's not one of the reasons why they do it. One main reason why the Unity project is there is work is there, so because they want to not have to develop, want the developers not have to develop each particular kind of form factor device. So the idea is to make some unified way of of having the desktop. So that this one's flexible, you can fit on tablets, on mobiles, etc. But they've kind of moved slightly away from this Unity idea at the moment. The same is true Windows, the Windows Active Tiles, the desktop for Windows. The reason why it changed to Active Tiles is so they could get a unified platform, a unified interface platform, so that it can work on all different types of form factor devices. That's why they want to do it. Why? Because it cuts down development time. No, you just have to do it once and hope all this, you can drag it in, you don't have to worry, you know. That's a big cost saving. The only way you can do that is by decoupling the interface from the program. Okay. So, how do I remember this? Footstool, that's how I remember it. So when you go to your granny's house, normally when I went to my granny's house all that time ago, she's dead now. But she had a footstool, okay? And that footstool, you'd just sit there in the big armchair, having a cup of tea, being brought biscuits and cake, and sit there in the big footstool. And what did grannies of the 70s call that footstool? What's the name of the footstool? It's called a poof. Do you not know this? Footstool is called a poof. And so that's how I remember that it's receivable, operable, open, understandable, and flexible. Okay, so it's footstool. Okay, so that's how I remember this. Now, how do we actually facilitate perceivability? So here's the question. I'm not even answered yet because I've written it down. Some of you have printed the slides back. Then they've already got the answers to this, but how do we facilitate these particular things? So how do we facilitate perceivability? How would you facilitate the they can be perceived? So let's have a look. Here are some questions to ask yourself. Does your system convey information by colour alone? So for instance, are you saying that, you know, when you're actually, here's one of the interesting systems. We have a system designed in the university called EEPROM, it's to manage PhD students, okay? And if there's something that's wrong on that PhD student, it shows a traffic light colour on it. So it shows a picture of traffic light with colour, green or red, that's the picture of that, or yellow or orange, amber, and yellow, it's going to go wrong. But there's no other differentiation. So if you're colourblind, there's no way you know what colour that is. So you know, you don't know whether you're overdue or not. Because there's nothing that says, you're overdue by 5 days. It just says, okay. Okay, it doesn't say it's just there. So you've got a problem. If you can't see it, there's no textual description. Okay. On the website for this course, you'll see there's a highlight and it says, current. You know, it's the current week. This is it says current week. And then there's ones with lines through the same tone. However, if it doesn't say done at the end, or the colour at the end, there's no way for that to be seen. It's not going to be red. The strike through has occurred, which means something. Or the background colour is yellow, which means something because it's like a highlight, so therefore look at this. If you're blind. Or if you've got colour blindness. Or if you're visually impaired. Okay, so that's one. Is there a succinct, meaningful name and label for each of the interface components? So we kind of talked about this last week, right? So therefore, have you got each component labeled? Okay. And if you haven't got each component labeled, why not? Because you need everything to be labeled so that the actual screen reader can read it. So even if it's an image or any kind of component, can it be read by its label? Is there an association from the label to the actual component? Can the user personalise the interface settings? So can they change the typography? Can they increase the size of the font so that they can see it if they've got a visual disability? Okay. Can they change the typography type? Because some people want serif and some people want sans serif. Okay? Fonts. We know about serif and sans serif fonts. Surely you're all doing it. That's the most basic part. themselves have little, like rotund dragons, have a little edges, little ends, and things without serifs, so you see this M, it's got these little things here. That's a serif. But if you look at the top font, the M, for instance, so serifs technically make it easier to look at, okay? Because, you know.
Because it's not supposed to, the serifs are supposed to draw the eye from the character, like this.
Yeah, the serifs are supposed to draw the eye from character to character. And while we didn't notice at the time, this is because of the cicadas we were talking about now, about 4 weeks ago, right? So, you know, I believe to move on this thing called the cicadas, and the idea is that the cicadas tags onto the serifs so that it moves you through the word more easily. And it showed that on printed work, that works very well. On long documents where you've got lots of reading, that likewise works very well. In some cases, electronically, where you've got not much text and the column size is short, less than 12 words a column, then it takes more time, okay, than a sans serif. People now prefer the sans serif oftentimes, although I've got to say that some of this is coming back because some of the droid fonts, etc., are coming back into fashion, so you've got some more sans serifs. You've got some more serifs here. Okay. But, so some of it is all about style, what people think about more than one, things like more than one. So, but some people don't like serifs, so it makes it more difficult for some kinds of people if you've got some sort of, sometimes people with dyslexia don't like that, they like, you know, it makes the people with dyslexia think that the serifs are more confusing, etc. So you have to decide, you have to allow the font to be changed so it fits the person. That's one thing. How easy is it to find any chat with interface controls and shortcuts? So on my Mac interface, it was very difficult because they sacrificed style for functionality in the context that on a Windows interface, I can tell what I need to, what the shortcuts are by association with the menu items, for instance. But on Mac, you don't get that really easily, especially depending on whether you switch on the accessibility features. So, because it doesn't look as pretty, so you have to just know about it. Have you provided keyboard focus and text cursors? Know your system, you saw a screen mistake and we're getting focus. So this is very important. So once, so if you lose focus, then you've got a problem. Because if you've lost focus, how do you get back to that particular point? So if I can't see that the focus has changed, then there's a problem. Okay. And if I don't know that anything's going to return back to where the focus my original focus was, that's also a problem. The same with if you're opening a separate window, or you're putting up the dialog box, the focus changes the dialog box, if it doesn't return to where you left it, then it's a big problem for people with sight. I have this problem a lot, actually, with Thunderbird. So Thunderbird, for little to no apparent reason, pushes me out, so it loses focus. And I'm typing in some random application, my shortcut keys, which is doing bizarre things. So, and then it took me to turn the focus. It's just car down there. Okay, openness. This is an easy one, right? Because we all know about open software and open systems now. So tell me, how might we, just some suggestions, how might we do openness? How might we facilitate openness? She's not here earlier, so we can only be tired at the back. Don't spend too much time. For student. Yes, so open to preview accessible API, that's one thing to ask. Yeah, that's one. Have I got an example? It's more work. easier to test, easier to manage the test forms. Good documentation, yeah, so that's about good documentation. We can't make, you know, the thing that people want is that documentation is, well, there isn't any documentation, that's the point, right? People don't want any documentation, but sometimes systems are too complex and you need some documentation, so that's okay. You need to be just complex enough. So, you know, there's a big thing in usability that used to be called make it simple, stupid. Okay, don't let people, don't think about it. Don't make people think about the interface. But that's it. Sometimes it's a complex job. And you need to think about the interface forward. Okay? So you need to be thinking about what you're doing. But you need to make it not complex. Yeah, not too complex, just complex enough. That might mean you need a new sort of presentation. Any more?
Free software.
Huh?
Free software.
Free software?
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm all for free software. You want free software, open source, all on GitHub, John's good. Yeah? What we got? How do you provide a simple and easy meaningful makebox, which is what we've already talked about, right? So how open is it that you can get to the actual interface? Is your software open source that its information is available to third-party systems? Okay? Via API, REST, RPC, SOAP, software as a service, platform as a service. All that kind of stuff is a good thing to do, because okay? Then you can make it open to all. Does your system allow input to manipulation by these third-party systems? Some don't. Okay, so sometimes third-party systems which are to do with accessibility, like JAWS or screen magnifiers, they actually can only do output. They don't really do much input. Can't do much manipulation. If your system is closed, then does it allow all inputs and outputs passed through third-party software? So sometimes your system's going to be closed, maybe. You've got no choice because you work with a map. And the map says you're going to have to run pretty much the 60s, of course, at this point. Cool, can I see capacity establishment. But you're working for these master grading corporations, and they won't allow you to make that stuff open. But what you've got to think is, if does all your information pass allow the information to pass through a third-party device. Okay, if it doesn't, not by calls, but by just pushing it out there, if it doesn't, then it means that as well. It means actually what it means is that none of your software will be bought by any government. Or any government organisation, or any organisation that is funded by the government. So, not just in this country, pretty much everywhere in Europe, anywhere in the Netherlands, anywhere in the Far East. Most places, the Middle East, same in Bush, same in London, pretty much. You can, you know, if you aren't able to access this information via other machinery, then you are, it's not going to be good. Because the law is in place to stop it being purchased, to stop public funding being spent on systems. Okay? Because they're not usable by the public. Alright, operability. I see we're getting close there. So, generally think about operability. Can the user control all aspects of audio and visual presentation? Can you make the video go slower? Can you make the video go faster? Can you slow the sound down? How do you make things, if it takes a long time for you to press a button to say stop, are you able to then press stop and it will go back a certain amount of time automatically? On your video, because otherwise you'd miss it. But it might take you 30 seconds to press stop. Press your play to control. This is a time limit. Okay. These look like they're kind of esoteric circuits, but actually they're W3C and ISO standards. You don't think about them, you don't have video software saying that the first case that does, it's true if you want to actually. Anyway, for most organizations, they're different. Yeah. Can we use a personalized interaction setup and change the length of any timed events? So, a timed event might be something that turns into a smile. No, I said my arm. Synchronized multimedia interaction language. Okay, well, carry on. So, if you want to synchronize multimedia this way, so you want to synchronize the audio with video, then you need to be able to change the actual settings for them, because it might very well be that you need a longer amount of time to understand what's being said than to see what's on the screen. So, to see what's on the screen. Therefore, if you've got text coming up, if you've got captioning, you might need that captioning to be up there for longer than the actual video plays. Okay? Or you might need to at least control it so that you can pause the video while you're reading the captioning. Or the video auto pauses while you're reading the captioning. Are all function interface components interaction able to be controlled by the keyboard? We've already said that. All function components interaction controlled by a mouse-like pointer. We've already said that. Multiple coded key presses available in sticky key sequential form. What the hell does that mean? What does this mean? Well, we see the same people with their hands up, or what some people. No, everybody always gets stuck. It's you guys over there, I'm looking at all these people who are not. You guys there, come on, your hands up. Are we coming to get you in the second session? You better get some coffee in here, get ready to answer questions. Come on! Or run like a bully. Run away. Okay. Yes. Very good, yes. So sticky keys, and why is that useful?
You go to the
computer to do a job. Yeah, if you don't have a shortcut, say, or you've got a tremor, or this kind of thing. It's also useful that if you're on a very jerky train or something, where you need to do some hot determination. So the whole point of this is that if you can't press two things at the same time, you need to press them in sequence. The way to do it is to keep one key stuck down while you're building a sequence of things to make it press. We've already said that you need focus, understandability. Understandability. Is there a meaningful name for that? We've said that. Are all interface control interaction features well documented? We've already talked about that. This. This is the big problem with lots of crap that I see out there. Everybody else has got things about it. Do all error or alert messages give consistent information? That's one. Appear in a consistent place, that's two, and facilitate movement to the site of those errors. So if you've got an error that's happened, how can you get to the site where the error is? When I put an incorrect credit card number, or in my in the online cart, and you go, no, incorrect credit card number, the whole page reloads, so I have to start again, because I don't know. And if you notice, you get a thing at the top, oftentimes you say, there's been an error, please correct the thing with the star. And then as you go down, there's a box highlighted in red. That's that. Right. So have one, I have to find the reason it's disabled, I have to listen to this whole damn thing again to get to this big error. And what's more, the error is highlighted in red. It didn't say there's been an error at the half of the time, it's just a nice little red box. Actually, printing some text there would make it look not as nice. Okay, so just put a little red line on the box. Great. That's great if you can see red. But not very good otherwise. So, do you follow the OS keyboard conventions and best practice and style guidelines? So, this is a big thing as well. All interfaces have style guidelines now. Look at your guidelines. Android has them, Mac has them, everybody has them. Okay? There's a big document if you don't want to develop the site. And you need to conform to those guidelines. You need to conform to those guidelines because if you don't, the interface as a whole is less understandable. Okay? Lots of people in the old Java days where you used to have the Java, where you used to build something in Java and you used to look like Unix, because that was the default style, it just used to wrap Unix into Mac looking style, for instance. And that was their idea of making the interface work on Mac. And that means that most of the people using Macs couldn't understand what the hell they were doing. Have no idea about what these different components do in Unix. Okay. Alright. Flexibility. Our last one. Does the system allow users to conform the colour encoding to their preferences? And the same is true for the text, right? But here's the flexibility. Can't be really seen. Can the user personalise the interaction settings? can you change the length of timed events? So if something's going, something's a timed event, can you change it? If something will flip off the screen after 3 seconds because it's an alert, can you make that 10 seconds? Think about if you're using a screen magnifier, whereby you magnify one part of the window, and so you've got a tiny little box, which is the size of the screen, but it's actually a viewport moving around the entire interface. If you put your alert somewhere for an error, how do you know that there's been an error? And if it goes away again after 3 seconds, how will a person ever know there's been an error? If you've got a really badly designed website and a very small mobile phone, it's exactly the same thing. You've got a viewport onto a static looking website, which you happen to scroll around and find out what the hell's there. That being the case, if you put the error somewhere off screen, you don't notify the person within the viewport, and you don't notify that person, and the error goes away. Well, it's dead, actually. But if the error goes away, how will that person know the error? Can the keyboard be remapped? Well, that's important because remapping the keyboard is very important for people with physical disability or tremor, because it might very well be that you can use one hand, but you can't use the other hand. If you've had a stroke, often it affects on one side of the brain, so therefore you might be paralyzed on the left side or the right side. And then you have to use this hand, or one hand for everything. But it's not very good. If you might need to have some key combinations that are back to just the right hand, it makes it easier. Do you allow keyboard shortcuts like accelerators to be personalised? Again, because it might be easier for somebody to select a certain set of key combinations. Maybe if you've only got 2 fingers, because you've had 2 fingers grafted on, because you have sort of just going to make them on, is not usable. Okay, lots of reasons why that might be the case. Okay, 10 minutes, so back at 08. Back at 08, 11:08, and then we'll get on to the next bit.